Kia ora, good evening. Easter is the season of the roar for New Zealand's deerstalkers when the stags are calling for a mate. And they say right now the central North Island bush is like Queen Street in rush hour as hunters move in for the kill. But a tragedy will happen before the season is over. A Kiwi hunter is mistakenly killed on average every 9 months. Worse still, 10 of the last 12 fatalities were killed by their own hunting party or a close mate. The theory is the more experienced you are as a hunter, the more likely you'll be to make that fatal mistake. Here's one such story, a powerful warning that if you hunt, this could happen to you. Amanda Miller reports. Rank of inspector.
To outsiders, they look like a couple, two people who need each other during a tragedy. But she is the widow, and he's the man who killed the love of her life. And she's standing by him.
I shot. And I really believed I'd shot a deer.
People will be astounded by your capacity to forgive.
I would never wish this on my worstest enemy. What he has to go through. It is hell on earth.
Gabby Molloy wants to share her story of forgiveness to prevent another death. And so does her partner's killer, Henry Wersp. But he's made a promise to the victim's family that's preventing him from speaking out.
Why would somebody agree to that?
Because he's a broken man. And he is doing everything that he can possibly do to alleviate everybody's hurt. And I do want Henry to be able to have a normal life again, and who knows if that'll ever happen, but we can't bring Dodsey back, and I don't want to forget him.
James Dodds, or Dodsey as he was known by everyone, was a world-class mountain biker and motocross racer, a sportsman with a smile as big as his appetite for adventure and racing. Together with his partner, Gabby Molloy, who was ranked in the country's top three female riders, the couple tore up the national and international mountain bike circuit.
We had a fairy tale life, absolute fairy tale.
The country's capital of mountain biking, Rotorua, was their kingdom, and they were the king and queen of their sport.
We often get called Dodsey and Gabbana, you know, as our little nickname, and I was just like, how am I going to be just Gabby? And it just seems so. Just to operate them.
The couple had been together for 10 years and Gabby shared Dodsey's passion for dirt, bike, speed and exhilaration. They travelled the world competing and building bike trails. Dodsey with a partner designed a revolutionary bike called the Zeroed while Gabby ran their coaching business.
I did always worry for his life, always. He was just always so full on. He was full on with motocross, he was full on with biking, he often got hurt. And a lot of people would say to me, oh, you know, how do you let him do those sports? And I'm like, are you kidding me? You can't stop him doing them.
Dodsey had another passion that took him off the dirt tracks and into the wilderness. He'd been hunting since he was 11.
To be able to go hunting, turn the phone off, out in the bush, just the silence, oh, he just loved it, eh? He's just out there to have time for himself.
One of Dodsey's hunting mates was his best friend, Henry Wersp, who had 17 years experience. He was also an outdoor safety consultant and a qualified paramedic.
They did click straight away. They're both real men of integrity and they did recognise it in each other.
On September the 7th last year, Dodsey got up before dawn to go hunting.
He just loved getting up early, he's so excited, and then and he came and gave me a hug and a kiss goodbye and told me he loved me. And the key thing of it, I went back to sleep.
Dodsey and Henry's path that morning took them into the southern Pairoa Ranges between Rotorua and Taupo. We were retracing their route with Detective Sergeant John Wilson, the officer in charge of the investigation, who also leads the region's search and rescue operation and is a hunter himself. But back on that morning, the two experienced hunters were excited. They'd heard there were fellow deer out there, and 30 minutes into their walk, they made their first mistake.
They became separated. Now, that wasn't an intentional separation. That was caused more by the lay of the land than anything else. But as a result of that, Dodsey actually ended up getting ahead of Henry. And we think what happened is he sat down and he's waited for Henry to catch up with him.
Then the second mistake. Henry heard something that made him think Dodsey was following him. And then he was convinced he saw a stag ahead.
So he's made an assumption that Dodsey's behind him, so therefore what he's seen in front of him can't be Dodsey.
But it was his mate Dodsey. This is a photo of him taken about an hour before Henry would shoot him. As well as wearing camouflage, he had on this backpack, its colours and design spookily similar to a fallow deer. And from a distance of 34 metres, this is what Henry would have seen through the scope of his rifle. To illustrate the line of fire, Detective Wilson has set up a colleague in a high-vis vest to show us where Dodsey was.
As you can see, there is a clear corridor between the position of Henry when he took his shot and Dodsey. And he obviously could see him, he just mistook what it was that he saw.
Can you begin to understand how that could happen? I mean, this seems to me, I'm not a hunter, but this seems to me an incredibly open piece of bush. How on earth could he have got it so wrong?
Yeah, I'm at a loss, having visited here several times now and seeing just how open it is, how it could have happened. However, I do understand how it came about. It all started where they were talking about there being fallow deer here in the reserve. And I think that planted the seed in Henry's mind and led to what followed. Henry saw what he wanted to shoot and he shot it, so it was no accident, but it was a tragic mistake.
Up next on 60 Minutes, Gabby Molloy comes to terms with losing the love of her life and also accepting their best friend killed her partner.
He wouldn't look at me, and I had to keep like, saying, Henna's, and just pulling him up and saying, look at me, I'm going to be OK, I'm going to be OK. And he's like, Gabs, I'm so sorry.
Henry Wersp had just shot and killed his hunting mate James Dodds instantly. He then raced to the top of the ridge to call for help. Police comms would keep him on the line for the next 30 minutes to try and calm him down.
I woke up that morning and he would have actually already been dead when I woke up. And I got a phone call from one of my best friends, and she rang, and phone call was a little bit funny. She said that the EPIRB had gone off. Unless one of them was in dire, dire straits, that EPIRB wouldn't have been set off. And so I knew that because Henry had to have set it off, that Dodsey had been hurt badly. Then my neighbour turned up, who's a detective, and another friend of mine who's a detective, and as soon as I saw that car, knew.
Not only do you have to accept that you've lost the love of your life, but you have to come to terms with the fact that one of your best friends killed Dodsey.
Yeah, I mean, I always thought you'd die in a car crash or a plane crash. I often said that to him, you know. I worry, you know, that you're going to die before me. And he was always, don't think about it, don't think about it. I never thought that he'd die with anyone else involved. Who does think that?
Gabby was desperate to be reunited with Dodsey and insisted against all advice on seeing him.
And I wanted my last memory of him to be how he looked when he was him. I mean, he used to hang the deer up there, and I actually got so many memories of him with deer and just that grin from ear to ear, just covered in grass and blood from the animal, and just so happy. And he looked just like that. And so that was really cool. I was really happy that I saw him that day.
A criminal investigation had begun, but Gabby talked police into allowing her to meet with her man's killer face to face.
No one else was there. They don't see the pictures you have in your head, and I knew that he was going to have those pictures and those smells and how horrific that would be for him. And I wanted to know how he was. He wouldn't look at me, and I had to keep like saying, Henners, Henners, and just pulling him up and saying, look at me, I'm going to be okay, I'm going to be okay. And he's like, Gabs, I'm so sorry. He just could hardly breathe. He could just, it was just like, I was so worried for him. I just thought, seeing him like that, that we may never see the old Henners ever again, that he might just be, just that instant and changed all of our lives. I know I was pretty calm, I guess, because I didn't want to think I was going to lose it.
But you have every right to lose it. This was the man that had killed Dodsey, the person that you loved more than anyone else in the world.
Why wouldn't you want to be angry? Why wouldn't you want to...
Because I didn't feel angry. I never, ever felt angry. Ever. Never even entered my mind. It was just straight sadness. Because he didn't intend to do that. He was absolutely certain he saw a deer that day, and he still is to this day. And I think even if I did feel angry, I probably would make a conscious decision not to be angry at him, because he is plenty angry enough at himself.
Henry Wirth pleaded guilty to a charge of careless use of a firearm causing death. And Gabby was in court to support Henry. But two members of James Dodds' family didn't share her forgiveness. They wouldn't be interviewed or even identified by 60 Minutes.
One of the members was saying that they were never, ever going to forgive Henry.
But that's there. That is, they are totally entitled to that. Totally entitled to that feeling and anger, and because that's their road. It's not my place to judge.
A restorative justice meeting with Dodsey's family did little to fix the rift, and it was there that Henry agreed to never speak to the media about the shooting.
What does that say about Henry?
I think he has incredible integrity for doing that.
Because he gave that guarantee, and that was quite a few months ago when he was particularly vulnerable. I mean, he still is now.
Yeah.
But he is standing by that agreement.
Yeah, and he will always stand by that.
Despite facing a jail sentence of up to 18 months, Henry Wirth received a sentence of 6 months home detention, thanks in part to a letter from Gabby asking he stay at home with his wife and their young sons, aged 4 and 6.
But the public will be saying that Henry got off lightly.
I can understand that. I don't think it would have mattered if you locked him up for 10 years. It'd still be the same thing going on in his head as far as his own pain for what he's done.
Do you swear by Almighty God the evidence you should give today in this inquest shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I
This month, Henry Wirth took the stand one last time at the coroner's inquest.
On the 10th of January 2013, I was convicted of careless use of a firearm, causing death in relation to an incident on the 7th of September 2012, where I shot and killed my friend James Dodds.
Every 9 months, the life of a Kiwi hunter is lost in the bush, and everyone in the courtroom, including the coroner, Wallace Bain, wanted lessons to be learned from James Dodds's death.
There are a huge number of experienced hunters have written in saying they probably won't go hunting again because someone like Henry Wirth was going to make that mistake. How can they be certain they will never make that mistake? It's a difficult matter. So the more publicity you can give it, the better.
Overall, I think the most important safety messages to get out are don't be too blasé about the possibility of wrongly identifying your target. It can happen to anyone, not just other people. Don't split up, wear human-looking clothing, and be open-minded about using technology as another layer of safety.
In an effort to try and save the life of another hunter, Henry's supporting a new safety product, which is a world first. It's called the Iris, and it's poised to be big in New Zealand and also the United States, where a hunter is killed every second day. Two-thirds of those hunters are accidentally killed by their mates. Unable to sleep one night, Henry stumbled on the Hunter's Safety Lab website and recorded his story.
And I shot, and when I arrived at the deer, I found out that I'd shot and killed my mate.
Henry had searched worldwide, only to find the company Hunter Safety Lab in Wellington. Michael Scott is one of the creators of the Iris.
Well, he just said he'd seen what we were doing and was really excited about its potential to help prevent other similar accidents to his, and he was keen to find out more.
Hunters apply adhesive tape that's set off in an instant alarm when the hunting mate has his partner in his sights.
I guess some hunters would say it will make them too reliant on your product.
Well, it's like all safety technology, like helmets, airbags, life jackets. They add an additional degree of safety, and that's all we're saying. We're not saying this product replaces any of the rules of safe hunting, but if hunters use it, they can improve their safety.
6 months after losing the man she thought she would spend the rest of her life with, Gabby's still living at the 12-hectare property she and Dodsey bought on the outskirts of Rotorua. These days, her constant companion is a stray that turned up on her doorstep 2 years ago, aptly named Solo.
Every morning I get up and I make myself a coffee and just sit with my dog and just let the thoughts pass. And that helps me a lot because I get that time just to let it all go. And if I cry, I cry. If I don't, I don't. We would have gotten married one day. We just, it was never massively on our cards. We weren't really stressed about that or anything.
In the weeks before Dodsey died, he and Gabby had talked about slowing down their petrol and pedal-powered life and eventually having children.
We were all going to landscape all around and then it would have fenced up the sides of the driveway because at the moment the goats go all over the place. And
Dodsey had bought his own bulldozer and the couple had cleared a site at the top of their property. The drawn-up plans for their dream home have now been shelved.
I don't think I'd want a dream home without, I guess,
the dream man.
Yeah.
My
trucks are down
there. You're up in, it is virtually the wilderness. You're on your own. You're in this, in this place that is so much Dodsey.
He's
everywhere, he's all around you. How do you deal with that when that is something that's just inescapable?
I like having him all around. Yeah, you do bump into it all the time. You know, it's just, he's everywhere in here, everywhere. But I don't know, I don't really want to forget him, so it's nice to have him around.
One thing Gabby will never part with is Dodsey's ashes. Wherever her future takes her, he will go too.
God, that was a... There's no feeling like picking up the love of your life in your hands in a little box. The weight of those ashes. Yeah, I'm angry at the universe for taking him away from me and leaving me behind. But that anger has never had any relationship to Henry. And that's just my take on it. I'm a strange person, and that isn't very normal. I know that, but that's just how I tick.
And she's even getting her firearms licence so she can hunt, to have one more connection to the man she will always love.
I want to do right by Dodsy, and I want to do right by me, and I want to partake in life again. And hunting was something we liked doing. And Dodsy would think I was a pussy if I didn't go and do it.
Whatever is going to happen to 33-year-old Gabby Molloy in the future, she'll do it at full throttle with her best man along for the ride.
When it first happened, I really felt that I would never be able to swing my leg over a bike again, and I just couldn't do it. It's not, it's not Dodsy and Gabby anymore, but it's the pleasure from riding is deeper. Yeah, it feels like he's along for the ride, having a good time. And I think that now for me, I might have absorbed a little bit of that maybe here. That's how I feel when I ride my bike now. I'm just doing it because it's cool, having a good time.